We discuss in this video how to use kernels in linear regression. The key point is that the errors in a regression model measure the distance from the data point to the linear model in the same way as we had in the separation provided by the support vector machines. And so this means that much of the reasoning around support vector machines leading to the dual formulation of the problem and to the kernelisation of the problem can be applied here as well. So here is an example, and we will see how kernels can be used in combination with linear regression to get this. But this is the type of solution that you can hope to get. So this is a typical case of a linear regression. We are looking for some sort of an objective function in such a way that all these data points, they are at some minimum distance overall from this model. But then when you apply kernels, you could also get something else. You could get a sort of a parabola in such a way that also in some sense the distance of these data points to the parabola is minimized overall, but you could also get other things, more sophisticated objective function, in the same way that in some sense the error function overall is being minimized as a distance of these data points to the model that we are looking for. So in these pictures, this is a standard regression. The second one is using a quadratic kernel, and the third one is using a Gaussian kernel with two different spreads. So what we are looking for is, in linear regression in general, we are looking for a model in terms of a function. It's a function of x, and it's of the form W transposed x. And the point of linear regression is that we are looking to estimate the optimal vectors W and W0 in such a way that this error function that measures the distance somehow from the label and the predicted value of a data point xt, this is minimized. And very often, I mean, we take as an error function the sum of squares. So that's going to just measure the distance between the label and the predicted value for this data point, and takes the square. And overall, over the whole data point, over the whole data set, we take this sum of errors, and we try to minimize that, find the vectors W and W0 that minimize this global error function. The problem with this, using this particular error function, is that we don't really see the dot product, which was opening the door to kernels and the kernelized version of the support vector machine. So in that sense, if we want to use kernels, it's quite difficult with this error function. But we can replace this error function with something else. We can in fact write another one which follows the same concept of minimizing the distance between the data point and the model, but it does it in a little bit different way, which is going to allow us to see those dot products and open the door to all the other considerations we've had for kernels. So we are going to replace it with the so-called epsilon sensitive loss function, and this is an error function. I'm going to write epsilon here. It's a parameter. So this is, again, a function of two parameters. One is the label and the other one is the predicted value for this data point. And this, in fact, is going to be defined through two cases. On one hand, it's zero if the distance between the label and the predicted value is quite small. And it's, in fact, smaller than epsilon. And if it's larger than epsilon, then we are going to get this, this distance between the label and the predicted value. So what this does is it's saying, you know what, if you are close enough with your prediction to the label, close enough in terms of an epsilon that you can choose yourself as a parameter, then I will not count that as an error. I'm going to give it a slack, and I'm going to say this is close enough for me, this doesn't count as an error. But if you are further away, I'm going to take this distance and overall try to minimize this error function. So and also the other point is that the error in a data point is going to contribute to the global error function in a linear fashion and not in a quadratic function as we had before. So in that sense, this error function, this epsilon-sensitive error function, is somewhat more tolerant to noise. The noise is going to contribute less to the overall error function. Now, the way to think about this is now going to be very similar to the support vector machine formulation, and we are going to, if we just follow the same reasoning, this problem is going to translate into finding the vector W and the vector W0 that minimizes this error function, and that becomes, after the same reasoning as for super vector machines, is going to become this problem of minimizing the norm of W, and this was written down as minimize the 1 over 2 norm of W squared plus C times the sum over all the data points of some slack variables that we had also in the support vector machines. And in this case, we have two slack vectors, and I comment right away what's the point of these slack variables. This is an optimization problem subject to a number of constraints. On one hand, we have that the difference between the label and the predicted value should be at most epsilon plus xt plus. Then we have that the predicted value for this data point minus rt should be at most epsilon plus xt minus, and also we need to have that these slack variables are greater than or equal to zero, and we have this for all the data points t. So the point here is that these slack variables x that we are introducing for each data point, they account for the deviations of that point outside of the epsilon band around the optimal model. And it's going to be deviation on either on the plus side of the hyperplane or on the minus side of that hyperplane. And that's exactly the point of these inequalities. Here you have this deviation is on the plus side of the hyperplane, and this accounts for the case where the deviation is going to be on the minus side of the hyperplane, and so we have these two slack variables accounting for both sides. Just one more comment I want to make about this epsilon sensitive error function. Here in this figure you can see the difference between the quadratic or sum of squares error function typically used in linear regression, and here is where you see this epsilon sensitive error function, and that again contributes to the same point that this is a little bit more tolerant to noise. In other words, the noise contributes less to the epsilon sensitive error function than it does to the sum of squares. We can continue our reasoning in the same way as we did for super vector machines, and we can write the Lagrangian for this problem, and this is going to look like this. The Lagrangian is going to be LP is equal to 1 over 2 the norm of W, and remember the idea was that the constraints should be integrated into the optimization function. And so this is done with, we introduce a constant C, and we have a sum by xt plus and xt minus, and then we have also minus sum by t of alpha t times epsilon plus xt plus minus rt plus w transposed xt plus w0, then we also have minus sum by t alpha t, this should have been alpha t plus, we have alpha t minus here, and this is going to be epsilon plus xt minus plus rt minus w transposed xt plus W0. And then finally, we have minus sum by t, and we have some new Lagrange coefficients for the slack variables. On one hand, we have mu t plus for this xi t plus, and on the other hand, we have this mu t minus xi t minus. And this is exactly the same idea of how to introduce a Lagrangian for an optimization problem that we have seen for supervector machine. The only thing is that we have now more constraints, so there are more terms in this Lagrangian over here. And so the problem here is going to be that we would like to minimize this Lagrangian with respect to these vectors w and w0, and also with respect to these slack variables xi plus and xi minus. And on the other hand, we would like to maximize this Lagrangian with respect to these alpha plus and alpha minus and mu plus and mu minus. And just like before, we are going to just observe that this optimization objective can be switched. We can do first the minimization by w and w0 and then xi, and only then we can do the maximization by alpha and mu. And when we think about it like that, we can then take the idea that we can calculate the partial derivatives of this Lagrangian with respect to w, w0, and xi, and set them to zero to get our extra constraints. So here is how this goes. We take the partial derivative with respect to w, and this, when we calculate, is going to be w minus sum by t of alpha t plus minus alpha t minus times xt, and we are setting this to zero. So what this implies right away is that as soon as we solve the problem in terms of alpha, then we get the optimal value for w. W is going to be exactly equal to sum alpha t plus minus alpha t minus times xt. Then we have the partial derivative of this Lagrangian with respect to w0, and that's going to be equal to sum by t alpha t plus minus alpha t minus, and again we are setting this to zero, and we get one more constraint to our problem. Then we calculate the partial derivative with respect to xi in point t, and we take the plus version of this slack variable, and this in fact is equal to c minus alpha t plus minus mu t plus, and again we set this to zero, and we do the same for the other slack variable in point t. So this is the minus version, and when we do that, we get that it's c minus alpha t minus minus mu t minus, and again we are setting this to zero. So when we are taking all of these constraints and we introduce them in the Lagrangian, what we are going to get is the new Lagrangian. This is the dual version of the Lagrangian, is going to be Ld is equal to, and we get minus 1 over 2 sum by t and sum by s of alpha t plus minus alpha t minus. Then we get again alpha t plus minus alpha t minus, times xt transpose times xs, and then we get minus epsilon sum by t alpha t plus plus alpha t minus plus sum by t r t times alpha t plus minus alpha t minus. And this is subject to, so this is going to be a maximization function by alpha, and this is going to be subject to having these alphas, both the plus version and the minus version, in between 0 and c. And at the same time, we should also have that the sum by t of alpha t plus minus alpha t minus should be equal to zero. So this now goes the same way as in support vector machines. This is a convex optimization problem and it can be solved. It has a unique solution. And we are going to get our solution, and that's going to allow us to calculate our vector w based on this constraint over here. And then we are going to think about our data point and what does it mean that they are within or outside of the epsilon band of error. And the point is that those data points that fall within the epsilon band of error will have their alpha t plus and alpha t minus both equal to zero. And again, the point here is that they are fitted with enough precision and don't really contribute to the calculation of w. So that points out that even though this w seems to be a sum over all the data points in our data set, in fact, to this sum, you will only get contributions from those data points that are outside of the epsilon error that we are looking for. So hopefully in the optimal solution, there will be quite a few data points that contribute to this W. And we can use this expression of W as a combination of these support vectors to go back to our original problem and to realize that the linear regression function we seek is in fact the following. I'm going to write it here. It's going to be in fact f of x is, remember the original format was w transpose times x plus w0, but the moment we introduce, instead of w, we introduce this form that we get from this solution, this is in fact going to be equal to sum by t alpha t plus minus alpha t minus xt transposed times x plus w0. And so this is good news because all of a sudden we got our dot product that we were looking for. And the moment we have this dot product in the objective function that we are trying to get in the regression problem, it means that we can do the kernel trick. We can replace our data points with much more features, and we can do that through a well-chosen kernel function. So just to give you an example here, again I'm coming back to these three graphs that I showed in the beginning of this video. On this side, you see the standard linear regression, but it's formalized with this concept that we are looking for an epsilon band of error. So in this figure, what you will see is that there are a number of data points, these ones, that are within the epsilon error. And in that sense, they don't contribute anything to the optimal solution. They are just close enough to it. Those that are driving the optimal solutions are going to be those that are outside of the epsilon error. And some of them are going to be exactly on this margin, epsilon, and they are going to be, they will be the so-called support vectors. And there will be also these extra data points that are even further away from this epsilon band of error. In the same way, we have here this quadratic regression, and this is done based on the quadratic kernel. And the effect you are getting is that you are going to look for a fit along a parabola, and with the same idea that those points that are within this epsilon band of error, they don't really count towards the error function, but those outside, they do count, and they are the ones that help define the optimal parabola to be chosen. Same idea in here. We are getting a quite sophisticated objective function, but this is done again using the standard linear regression model. The only thing is that we are using the kernel trick, and in this case we are applying in fact the Gaussian kernel, and there are two different examples, one with a spread of 5 and the other one with a spread of 0.1.